Bibles to the book of 2 Samuel chapter 9. 2 Samuel chapter 9. I want to apologize in advance because I'm already drunk in the spirit. On my way here from the early service, the Spirit of the Lord once again spoke and said, "Straight raised, but Jesus saved." As we continue this series of Word Saving Part 2, you're looking at someone who should have been thrown away, should have been a different storyline. But Jesus said, "Word Saving." And when I think about ending, but the author of my life.
Thank you! Thank you!
For its sake.
Thank you! Thank you!
Turn your Bibles to 2 Samuel chapter 9.
Thank you, God. Thank you.
Sometimes you gotta put your education to the side. Samuel chapter 9. Look at verse number 7 and verse number 8. And then I'll do my very best to be. It says in verse 7, "Don't be afraid." David said to him, "For I will surely show you kindness for the sake of your father Jonathan. I will restore you all the land that belonged to your grandfather Saul, and you will always eat at my table." Verse number 8, in conclusion, Mephibosheth bowed down and said,
"Come on.
What is your servant that you should notice a dead dog?" Take your seats and say, "I'm word saving.
Word saving.
I'm word saving." This is the story of a king's kid living beneath his full potential. Mephibosheth has been robbed of his true value. Can someone here relate to this, that life got so hard, you lost your true value, right, your true identity, right, and you start operating not in your call, not in your anointing, not in your greatness, but you start operating according to your situation and circumstances? Has anybody here ever been victim of your own circumstances, where you start being identified by who you were instead of, you've been identified by what you were going through instead of who you were? Mephibosheth's life proves to me that life is comparable to a horrible roller coaster ride full of ups and downs and every now and then violent twists and turns. Has anybody here ever experienced a roller coaster of life where one day you were up and the next day you were down, and in between being up and down, your life was being tossed from side to side like a violent roller coaster? You had to just hold on instead of getting thrown off. Have anybody here relate to Mephibosheth's story that And one day you woke up and your whole life had changed for the worse. Your whole life had changed for a negative. One day you woke up and your loved one was gone. One day you woke up and the marriage was over. One day you woke up and they fired you from the job. One day you woke up and sickness had attacked your body. One day you woke up and the doctor said a cancer resides in your body. It's different than the day before. Has anybody ever experienced a negative experience that didn't give you a forewarning? It just showed up in your life. Fellowship. But in spite of what it looks like, because in this verse, in this text, it looks like he's losing. It looks like he's hopeless. It looks like he's over. He even defies and describes himself as being a dead dog. Not just a dog, but a dead dog. You know, have you ever seen a dead dog's body on the side of the road? When a dead dog is on the road, people still run over it because it has no value. But people shall see himself as being so low. He calls himself a dead dog. If you're not careful, life will have you calling yourself the most negative image. If you're not careful, life will have you confused, have your mind combined. Instead of calling yourself kings and queens, life will have you walking around talking about you a bad bee. Sometimes.
Yes, it will.
Just happens.
Yes, it does. Yes, it does.
With no notice. No forewarning. No forecast. It just strikes. But no matter what it looks like, if you keep reading the story, that's why you can't quit on you. If you keep reading the story, don't quit this chapter. Don't quit this episode. Don't quit this season. Just keep reading the chapter. Because even though it looked like Mephibosheth was hopeless, it looked like it was over, but the God that I serve said Mephibosheth was worth saving. And I want you to tell yourself this morning, don't worry about your neighbor right now. I actually need you for one time in your life to really be spiritually selfish and tell yourself you're worth saving. I say it like you mean it. You're worth saving. I know you're going through hell and high water, but you're worth saving. I know life hurts, but you're worth saving. I know you're crying at night, but you're worth saving. I know you made some mistakes, but you're worth saving. I know depression knocks at your door, but you're worth saving. I know somebody gave up on you, threw you away, but you're worth saving.
You're worth
saving.
In spite of what it looks like. Let me share with you. Growing up, my grandfather called him Daddy Abram. Kind, generous man. But you know, Mr. Davis, he got on my nerves. Because I was this young boy growing up in the hood with swag. I mean, I wore designer clothes daily, even though I grew up in the hood. But he would give me rides, and he would frustrate me and my cousin Missy because we would be riding all dressed up, and he'd stop on the side of the road and pick up an aluminum can and throw it in. I said, "Dad, you can't do that with me." He started recycling as a hobby. He didn't need the money. He just wanted something to do it. He started recycling as a hobby. And Mr. Man, he picked the worst times to get involved in recycling. I mean, I'm trying to get a reputation. Missy tried to come up behind me, and this man would pull over in front of our friends and pick up an aluminum can.
That's right. Hallelujah.
But I didn't understand the process of recycling at the time. I hated the fact he would recycle aluminum products until I rode with him to the recycling plant one day. And when he pulled up with what I thought was trash, what I thought was waste, what I thought was junk, when he pulled up the space to the recycling plant and they cut him a check and I beat the check and said, "Whoa, there's value in recycling." And what am I telling you this morning about recycling? Let me give you the definition, Deacon Jones, of recycling. Recycling is the process of converting waste material into reusable objects to prevent waste of potentially useful materials. The Greenhouse International Church is really a recycling center where instead of your life being wasted, you get a chance to be recycled. And what others call waste, God takes you through the recycling process. And and God gives you new value. See, the aluminum can, the beer can on the side of the road has no value to somebody. Somebody rejected it. Somebody used it. Once they used it up, they threw it away. If you're not careful, people use you up and throw you away. But thank God, God will step in and recycle you. Because when God recycles you, you get your value back. Oh, I'm so glad that God saw me worthy enough to recycle me when the world tried to use and abuse me. Oh, I wish I had somebody this morning that felt like celebrating the fact that God deems you worthy to be sick. That God didn't throw you away and call you waste products, but God saw the potential. Even when you look like a waste product, God saw the potential in you, and God picked you up and recycled you. Do I have any recycled believers in the house? And God, not only says your life is worth saving, but your life would not be wasted. See, God saved us, Chase, because God had plans to use us to do something great. I know the world has misused you, but God saved you to bring him glory. That's why God didn't let you stay on the side of the road. That's why God didn't let you stay in the dumps of life. That's why God sent the word to reach you at your lowest point. Can you imagine when the cork was sitting on the shelf, it had its highest value? When the beer can was sitting in the store on the shelf, it has its highest value. People actually leave the comfort of their house, get in their car, and drive to the store to buy the coke, to buy the beer. But once they use it up, they throw it away. If you're not careful, the church will use you up and throw you away. Once you sung your last song, once you preached your last sermon, once you gave your last dime, when they can't use you no more, they'll throw you away. But I thank God we got a recycling bin. I thank God that when the church throw you away, that God will find you, that God's grace will find you. Another term I want to introduce to you is this term called resale. Resale items are no longer wanted by the original owner, but it still has great value to somebody else. There are some women in here who they love to go thrift shopping and resale shopping. See, to somebody else, it's just waste. To somebody else, it's unwanted. I don't want that no more. I can't fit that no more. I've already worn it enough. It has no value to me, so I'll just give it away. See, to the resale shop, but to the individual at the resale shop, what you call waste, they call a value. Many have thrown you away. Many family members away. But I dare you to shout right now that God didn't throw you away. Anybody glad that when family and friends turned their back on you and bumped out on you and devalued you and talked about you and criticized you and stabbed you in the back? Has anybody here ever been with Job's wife? Anybody ever had to live in a house with a fool? Anybody had a lying brother like Joseph? Anybody been turned on by family and friends? But thank God, God didn't turn on you.
Thank you, Lord.
Notice. Come here for a second. Notice. As long as you're distant, I can't stab you in the back. I can only stab you in the back if I'm close to you. So if you've ever been stabbed in the back, it had to be by somebody that you allowed to get close to you. See, I don't mind a stranger stabbing me in the back. I don't mind a stranger lying on me. I don't mind a stranger hurting me. I don't mind a stranger setting a booby trap for me. But what breaks my heart is when I let somebody get close to me, close enough to, see, here we should have been embracing like brothers. Yeah, I'm stabbing you in the back. Why I cry? Because I trusted you and you.
That's why.
You told me you had my back, but I didn't know you had my back.
That's so good.
Let me, honey, let me talk about, before I get back to the text, I'm trying to make it make sense to you. I'm trying to reach the unchurched as well as the church. So before I break down the scripture, let me make sure that those who are unchurched feel welcome in the real church. Let's talk about a used car. Jesus spoke in parables. A used car has what's called depreciating value. But to somebody, it's still valuable. The used car philosophy should be the philosophy of the church. Watch this. To the original owner, the used car has depreciated so much, they decide to trade in, to get rid of it, to get it out of their possession. But watch this. There's a single mother standing at the bus line with three children in the rain. And then she get her income tax check. And she's able to buy a used car with depreciating value. But to that single mother with the three kids at the bus stop in the rain, that's not a depreciating value. That's a valuable, priceless vehicle. Because now to get my babies off the bus stop, I can get my babies out the rain. See, the value is in the eye of the beholder. And I'm glad God never took his eyes off of me. I'm glad when somebody else traded me in, because it looked like my value was depreciating. I'm glad when somebody said he no longer has any value. His value has depreciated. That God never took his eye off me. Is there anybody here and you're glad God never took his eye off you? I know some folks look at you cross-eyed, but God look at you with the eyes of love. Because God don't see you where you're at. God see you where you're going. Copy of Rahab from last week. God didn't see her as a prostitute. God saw her as a prophet.
Thank you, Lord.
Yeah, I'm trying to calm down. I'm trying to calm down. See, God would not let your potential go to waste this season. Not this season. Talk back to the preacher. Not this season. I know you had some L's last season, but not this season. I know you had some bad experiences last year, but not this year. I know some folks shut you up last time, but not this time. I know some folks promised you something, and then they reneged on your promise, but not this season. God will restore you and turn all your losses into new victories. And you'll be able to celebrate because you know what it feels like to be hurt. You'll be able to celebrate because you know what it feels like to have pain. And I dare you right now, everybody in here has ever experienced a real ill, a real loss, went through real pain, real heartache, real misery. Anybody here ever went through a grieving season? Anybody here ever been hurt by life? Anybody here ever been damaged goods? I dare you right now to give God a shout of praise. I dare you right now, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. If God has restored you and recycled you, I dare you give God some praise. Because there's somebody on your wall that's going through something right now. There's somebody on your wall ready to throw in the towel. There's somebody who's low in their finger. There's somebody about to run out of spiritual gas. There's somebody that's ready to quit. And your next shout won't be for you. Your next shout will be for your brother and your sister. I tell you right now, celebrate it. Celebrate it. Celebrate it. True value, not your markdown value, not your leftover value, not your has-been value, but God sees your true value, because when God created made you. God said, I made you in my image. And if you can't shout about you, can you shout about God? And if you can shout about God, you gotta be able to shout about you, because God created you in his image. Like a used car, you may have been through some stuff, but God is getting ready to restore you back in position, and your current value will be higher than ever before, because God says, high five, somebody say, God says, your word saving. After all you've been through, after all you've been through, restoring you. Because while you were going through what you went through, God never stopped declaring you were worth saving. Well, watch this. This is going to mess the church up right here. Do I have anybody here to deal in classic cars? Anybody deal in old school cars? Well, watch this. You take an old car. You take an old junk car. And when you take that junk car and put it in the right hands, they take that old car and they restore that car. And when they restore that car, it's no longer called an old car. Now it's called a classic. And a classic has more value than a showroom car. See, it's not an old jalopy anymore. Now it's a classic. Do I have any classics in the house? Do I have any classics in the house? Anybody, your value is not depreciating. Your value is actually increasing. Because God didn't see you as a jalopy. God saw you as valuable. I was watching Fred Sanford and Son. And you know what came to my mind with Fred G. Sanford? You know, his business was a junk man. So that meant that every time you saw a customer come to Fred's house, they were coming to buy something that somebody else called junk. Every time you come to God's house, God is looking at you what somebody else called junk. But God said, I want you. Turn to your neighbor right now and say, God wants you. I think by now we're ready to get to the text. Turn your Bibles back to the book of 2 Samuel. Journey around verse 4 in chapter 4. Something very interesting occurs. 2 Samuel chapter 4, verse 4. It begins the introductory story of Mephibosheth, the man we just saw who called himself a dead dog. But how did he articulate to this point in life? And let's go back to the beginning. Because we can't make the error of misjudgment that the church has been found guilty of. The church will see you at a certain chapter of your life and try to judge you based on the current chapter without reading the previous chapters. I didn't just get here by myself. There's some stuff that happened to get me here. I didn't just get depressed because I like being depressed. I didn't just get mad because I like being mad. I didn't just become an angry black man because I like being angry. That was some stuff that happened to me. She didn't just get on the pole because she's like swinging on the pole on Friday night. Somebody touched her. Somebody abused her. Somebody dropped her. Somebody let her down. So I don't want to operate with a judgmental spirit and look at Mephibosheth in the chapter where he calls himself a dead dog. How did he get to this point? How did he get here? It's the question. So 2 Samuel chapter 4, verse 4, it says, Jonathan the son of Saul had a son who was lame in both feet. He was 5 years old when the news about Saul, his grandfather, and Jonathan, his father, came from Jerusalem. His nurse picked him up and fled, but as she was hurrying to leave, he fell and became disabled. His name was Mephibosheth. Mephibosheth, as you see in the text, was only 5 years old when his whole life turned upside down. He was a five-year-old prince. You know, his grandfather was the king, and his daddy was next in line to be the king. So he was a young prince, Mephibosheth. He wasn't a dead dog then. He was a young prince. At 5 years old, his daddy and his grandfather was defeated in battle at the same time. And the word spread that David was now the king of all Israel. You say, well, what's up with that? You gotta understand the custom and the history behind the story. Whenever a new king took office, his first assignment was to kill all the male descendants of the previous king. Because if the new king didn't kill all the male children of the old king, then the old king's children, sons, would one day rise up and attack the new king. So David had to go and kill all of Saul's boys, because if he didn't kill all of Saul's boys, then one of Saul's boys would rise up against him. Are you understanding that story? David had to kill all of Saul's boys. So Mephibosheth's nurse heard the news. She picked up the five-year-old boy and tried to get out of Dodge, tried to get out of town, but she tripped, stumbled, and fell, causing Mephibosheth to stumble and fall and to crush his ankles and to crush his joints. So now he was disabled. The king's boy is now disabled. Because if his nurse wouldn't have gotten the news, and they didn't have texts, Facebook, inbox, she didn't receive a fax. It took effort to get the news to his nurse. But God was the first Federal Express. God made sure his nurse got the news quickly so she could get Mephibosheth out of town, out of home, out of danger. Can anybody here shout that God, when your life was under attack, that God saw your life worth saving, and God got you out of a messed up situation? Has anybody here ever been in a bad relationship and that man you call Boaz became the money and you got out just in time because his next girlfriend didn't get out in time? Has anybody here, you ever been running in a circle of friends that were your homeboys and your homies, and right after you got baptized, right after you started coming to church, they all got locked up?
Whoa.
I thought I was talking to a real church. Watch this, watch this. See, maybe you don't know the Bible like I know the Bible. His name was Mephibosheth. Someone say Mephibosheth. Now, I need you to study this at home. I give you homework every week. I pray you're doing your homework. I need you to study 2 Samuel chapter 21, verse 1 through 9, because a very interesting dialogue and story takes place in 2 Samuel 21, verse 1 through 9. I know you're not familiar with it, because you'll be shouting better if you're familiar with Mephibosheth. But see, what happens is, when David first became the king, he asked the question, is there anybody in the lineage of Saul still alive? And word got back, his son, Saul's son, Mephibosheth. I thought you said, Pastor, Mephibosheth was Saul's grandson. Peep this. Saul had a son named Mephibosheth, and Saul's son, Jonathan, had a son named Mephibosheth. Now, Mephibosheth, that was Saul's son. Remember, Saul was an evil king. Saul was a jealous king. Saul was a hating king. So when Saul came against the Gilonites, he killed the Gilonites. He abused the Gilonites. He mistreated the Gilonites. So when David became king, David took Saul's son, Mephibosheth, and turned him over to the Gilonites so he could get favor with the Gilonites, and the Gilonites killed Mephibosheth, the son of Saul. But David spared the life of Mephibosheth, the son of Jonathan. See, what was the devil thought an attack against you, God spared you. Is there anybody here? You're not shouting. not shouting over increase. You're shouting over what God did in that heaven. We get excited about what God brought us through, but you ought to be just excited about what you didn't allow you to go through. There were some attacks with your name on it that God rerouted. There were two Mephibosheths in the Bible.
Okay.
One got grace.
Come on, teach man of God.
And one got judgment. Have you ever reflected on the things God didn't allow to happen?
Yes, sir.
Watch this. Because he deemed you worth saving.
Yeah, right.
Not because you weren't in the wrong place. Not because you weren't guilty. Not because you weren't doing what everybody else was doing. But for whatever reason, God looked at you and saw enough value in you to spare you, because he still had purpose and assignment and destiny for your life. I wish y'all had some real believers in this house. You do know it could have been worse. You do know what you're going through could have been worse. And you do know if we really got what we deserve, all of us would be in an institution right now. You do know if we got what we really deserve, all of us would be out of our mind after all that stuff you smoked, after all that stuff you drank, after all them beds you've been in and out of. All of y'all should have AIDS. The same joint you smoked and got quote unquote high. Somebody else smoked that same joint and their mind got discombobulated, and a 40-year-old still acting like a 20-year-old. It wasn't you didn't hit it, God just spat. You sitting in the doctor's office, knees buckling. Shabbat, you just cleaning right now. Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Rapha, Jehovah Nisi. Who do I shout out loud? The grace of God.
Yes.
The grace of God. Incurable fellowship drops him. So he ended up in this place without doing anything wrong. Was shot down with a thug, gang banging, dope slanging Negro. Some good boys went to the grave early for no understandable reason, just except it happened, because sometimes life is a book of bad. Mephibosheth ends up handicapped. And for the rest his life, he'll be known as the crippled boy. But God declares he's worth saving.
Yeah.
It would have been easy to get rid of
That would have been easy.
The crippled boy.
Yeah. Yeah.
He can't fight in the army. He can't be used by nobody. Just throw him away. But God.
What's up?
Says the crippled boy has value.
Yeah.
That's why I work so hard for young men of color who've been in trouble and they have a stripe on their back. They have to operate, and every time they go to a job application, they gotta check the box that they've been in trouble. That's why I work so hard for, because everybody else is calling them by the label in the box, but I'm calling them a king. I'm calling them the next generation of leaders. I'm calling those who everybody else has given up on. If you do know I got crazy dreams, I'm dreaming of one day I'm gonna march downtown with 10,000 black men and brown men with felonies, and I'm gonna get them all registered to vote, and I'm gonna determine who's the next mayor, who's the next city council, who sits on the school board. I'm gonna take a generation of men who messed up and empower them and take the label off them and give them back their value, and we're gonna march up and down and take back our label. I dream crazy dreams like that. I dream a dream of an army. I went to the valley of the shadow of death. I saw a valley of dry bones, and God asked me, can these bones live again? And I said, God, heck yeah.
Yes, sir.
Watch this. Tweet this. Your situation can cancel your true value. Don't let a label trick you into believing you don't matter. God says you're worth saving. The label you wear may be divorcee, drug addict, convict, prostitute, dope dealer, gangbanger, baby mama, aborted, but the label will no longer define you. Because God said, in spite of your label, you're worth saving. We gotta rush to a close. Yes, Mephibosheth ends up in Lodabar. Lodabar. It don't even sound like a place you want to visit. Lodabar. We want to raise the bar. We don't want to end up in Lodabar. Lodabar is a place no one desires to end up in, but many end up in Lodabar, a low place. Is there anybody here transparent enough to really shout back at me that you once been in Lodabar? Or maybe there's somebody bold enough to say, preacher, I haven't been to Lodabar. I'm in Lodabar. I'm in a low place in my life right now. I'm in the lowest place I've ever been, but I'm not gonna stay here. I'm in the lowest place in my marriage. I'm in the lowest place in my finances. I'm in the lowest place of my mindset. I've never been this low in my life. I cry myself to sleep every night. We get all kind of stuff, and every morning when I wake up, I'm still getting it with the same hair. I need Lodabar. Everybody else may have abandoned me and left me, but the grace of God found me in Lodabar.
Yes, Lord. Thank you, God. Yes.
Because I kept reading the Bible. Yeah. And in 2 Samuel 9:1, years later, somebody say years later. I can't promise you're going to leave Lodabar tomorrow, but you will leave Lodabar. Because years later, David is now not just the king, but now he's the emperor. He was appointed king, but he won battle after battle and became the emperor. So David says, I know I asked this question a few years ago, but is there anybody left in the clan of my friend Jonathan? No, the first time he said in the lineage of Saul, but this time he says in the lineage of Jonathan. He had a negative relationship with Saul, but he had a covenant relationship with Jonathan. So now he poses a new question. Is there anybody in the house of Jonathan? And they say very quietly, because they remember what happened to the last Mephibosheth. But they afraid to tell David a lie, because you know David defeated the lion. You know David was a man that never lost a battle. So they said, King David, there is one more. He's a crippled boy down in the bar. His name is Mephibosheth. And David says, Deacon, I thought I already took out Mephibosheth. But David, there's another Mephibosheth, and he's been hid down in Lodabar. Do you get what I'm saying? He's been hid down in Lodabar. Sometimes God will hide you in some strange places. Sometimes God will hide you until he's ready to use you. Sometimes God will keep you in the wilderness because you're not ready for the mountaintop yet. Sometimes God will keep you behind the line because you're not mature enough to be in the front of the line. Sometimes God will let you go to jail and let you go to prison for a little while. But if you stay on the streets, you lose your mind. Sometimes God let the relationship get in trouble so you can realize how valuable the relationship is. Sometimes God let you spend a season unemployed so you'll value the next job, and you won't pay the next job was your source. But you say, God is my source. So sometimes God will hide you in lower bar until he get ready to call your name. Because when King David said, go get Mephibosheth, he said, go get him. And can I make up the tree right now? While you're in lower bar, God is calling your name. While you're going through hell and high water, God is calling your name. While you don't know how you're going to make it through, any coming from the north, any coming from the south, folks lying on you, folks talking about you, folks setting booby traps for you, and you about to lose your mind. But God is calling your name, and God is saying, go get him. I got something for him. Don't go too far with it. I'm going to use it for illustration just a second. God says, go get him. Go get him. Go get him. Go get him out of jail. Go get him out the crack house. Go get her out the whorehouse. Go get her off the pole. She all alone now. She swung on her last pole. Go get her. Go get him out the prostitution. Go get her out the unemployment line. Go get her out that abusive relationship. Go get her. Go get him. Everybody's here. And you're glad God called your name when you went on the bar. And when the Mississippi Shelf get before David, he says, David, oh, King David, why would you call a dog who don't like me? I'm not just a dog, Chad, but I'm a dead dog. I have no redeeming value. I have no qualifications. I've been disqualified a long time ago. Don't you see I'm crippled? I can't muscle move. I have no value. They told me I was crippled. They told me, Bennett, I'd never be anything. They told me, Bennett, my life was wasted. They told me, but God said, come. Is there anybody here? And God said, come. Is there anybody here? And feel like a dead dog because of what you've been through. But God says, come. You weren't saving. And this blessed me real good as I get ready to leave you. When David told Mephibosheth, he won't come to my house and you won't be my son. I'ma treat you just like I treat my own boy. That's why we pray to our Father. I don't care what you've been through. When God calls your name, he gives you a new identity. When God calls your name, he increases your value. When God calls your name, he restores you and recycles you. But nowhere did I read, Lord, that God healed Mephibosheth. Santo, he was still crippled. He was still lame. But when he got with God, it didn't matter. When he got with God, who he was no longer who he is. So now, the is at the table of the king for the rest of his life. But what you don't realize, he was crippled in his feet, and everybody saw his crippledness. So when God got him to the table, you might understand, at the king's table. So now can't nobody see what he been through. Can't nobody see what he came out of. I dare you to shout right here. Thank God I don't look like what I've been through. Thank God I don't look like what I've been through. He covered me up. He covered me up. He covered me up. He covered me up.
Yeah.